notifications are muted. My stream isn't the... scratching. What are you doing, pup? Why you gotta do this? She's so needy. She's so cute. The sounds aren't too loud. Show this off again later. I talked about it in Discord. I also didn't open the bot. I forgot. I got some awesome merch in the mail. You didn't miss anything. We're just starting. Miss like sitting here petting the dog.
So it's cover one of eight.
Genesis cover, 2 of 8. All of these covers are done by different people. These two in particular, cover A and B. Dervo, hey, what's up? A and B are Todd McFarlane art. Just one's black and white, obviously. This is cover C. It's all the same pose, just done by different artists. This one's a little bit shinier, different colors. Super Sweet Sauce, 3 of 8. This is cover 4 of 8. Different artist. See, it says Todd McFarlane. And then under it says MW. So I don't know what that's about. MW, that's a person. It's a relation to that comic from what I can gather. Religious restraint on an island. You're essentially their god and had to help them survive and solve the mystery of the island. Different games took place in different parts of the island. That sounds pretty good for a middle school era. Again. So that was cover 4. This is cover 5. I like Spawnscape in this. Looks almost like a statue. It's pretty sweet. Very gritty. So that was cover 5. This is cover 7. I think it appears to be like snow or frost that's all over. Very frosty. Oh, something I just noticed. The spawn name or lettering in the top is different. I just noticed that the other day someone followed the stream and their name is Ninja Hyper instead of Ninja Hyper. Just trying to copy Ninja. Come on, man. What are you doing? Okay. Next, we have issue 180. So we're a little under 2 years away from issue 200 of The Walking Dead. And this is the very unsettling Walking Dead 15th anniversary alpha cover for this month. Each month they do a different character. The first month was Rick. Show. Whispers. I'll talk about them in a little bit. This is the cover A for A New World Order. It's issue 6 of 6. So the story arc's over this month. And next month we'll get a new story arc. Maybe with Rick dealing with the Commonwealth a little bit more. So, the Whispers. As far as I know, I'm not too well read up on them because I'm still at like issue 110 or issue 120. It's a little before, it's still during the Negan time, a little before the Whispers, I think. Thousands of zombies. And they kind of hinted at it in the show in the last season. So maybe we'll see some Whispers in the show. But I'm not sure exactly how they came across Rick and the crew. And I'm not sure the resolution. Yeah, I think they're bad guys. And, you know, they probably had some conflict with Rick. And Rick was probably like, this is not safe to have a wandering pack of zombies. Classic Rick. Alright, next we have a one-shot. This is Dazzler number one. Dazzler's kind of like a classic character. I didn't get a chance to read this. I think there's a new Dazzler TV show, if I'm not mistaken. I know there's a Cloak and Dagger one. I'm not sure if there's a Dazzler. I thought I saw that there was a Dazzler thing. Maybe like a Netflix show or the Disney, whatever Disney's doing with their new subscription service. But Dazzler's a beloved character. Not a very well-known character. Neither is Cloak and Dagger. I'm not sure why they're doing a show about them, but they made Cloak and Dagger like teenagers, so they could be on fucking ABC. 8 hour better the story is find safe place, meet bad group over and over and over and over. Yeah. At least the bad group is always a little bit, you know, they're always different. They're always creative. Like the governor's people, they had their own town, and the governor was like a two-sided coin. He was a good guy and a bad guy. And then what was the next one? Oh, Terminus. Terminus was just weird in its own way because it was people who took over Terminus. And then there was Negan, who's really just a bad guy who has made a name for himself. I guess the Whispers are interesting in their own way because they control a group of zombies. That's interesting. And then there's the Commonwealth, which is basically a gigantic city. And they have an army of like thousands of thousands of soldiers to fight off the dead. So they, while it's the same basic plot, they change it up every time. It's not exactly the same, which is kind of refreshing with such a repetitive plot line. And you know, Walking Dead is more about the people rather than the zombies or whatever goes on. And yes, anyone watching, if you could please stream gets shown, and the more people can be exposed to the channel, it actually really helps, and it's free. You just click the link, let the page load, then exit out. It takes 2 seconds. It's not the people that took over Terminus, it's the original people who survived, that take over and then became bitter and distrust outsiders. It's the original people who survived, that take over and then became the bitter. Yeah. I mean, they ate people. No thanks. Alright, next we have Deadpool number 1, which is actually Deadpool issue 301. I'm not quite sure what Marvel is doing, other than trying to grab people's money, because they just want to sell new number ones. But it always seems like there's a new number one, like every month, of the same book that's been going on forever. But there's nothing spectacular to say about this book. It's a Deadpool book. They probably just wanted to sell because of the movie. Hey, those guys raped and murdered out people. Let's eat everyone. Also, that scene in the show where Glenn and Rick and Daryl are like at the trough about to get killed, and it just so happens that someone came, or Carol I guess it was, started shooting right as they were about to get killed, like plot armor. Just wish there was an actual plot, not just survive this new banger. I mean, what would the plot be? Basically, the whole plot is to survive, and the zombies can only do so much because they don't have, like, they're just like regular zombies. They don't have special zombies, or they haven't developed the zombies into more than just brainless beings. Okay, next we have a new Marvel number one. This is Doctor Strange number one. So is it Doctor Strange number 391. Again, it's not a bombshell issue. It's not a, I need this number one, because it's going to be $20 in a year. It's not going to be. It's going to be, I guarantee you, it's going to be a $5 book, $1 book. But the story's good, the art's good. It's seems like it's going to go in a nice way, nice piece, a nice place. I don't know if it's going to tie in with the Infinity Countdown stuff that's going on right now, though. I'm not sure. Any of those things, show has been going on. There's literally no central plot. I mean, with the book and the show, they can't really start to rebuild society, because that eventually means there's going to be an end, and the writers of the book and the show aren't the type of people to admit that there will be an end and want an end. They're not in it to tell this story, and just this story. Maybe a bit more so with the show, they definitely just want to keep milking it for as much money as they can. And it kind of sucks because, you know, if they had a central plot, and yeah, exactly, good shows know when to end, good writers know when to end their things. They know they have a story that they want to tell, and that's what they're passionate about. And I think Robert Kirkman, the writer for The Walking Dead, had that vision originally, but I think he's lost sight, and he's kind of grown tired of The Walking Dead, probably because of executives that want him to keep continuing this outcast, last. His other book is set to end. Invincible ended. Oblivion Song doesn't have an end in sight, but seems like he's working towards a story that could end at some point sooner than The Walking Dead. Spoiler. Tabitha. For those of you who don't know, Tabitha is the goat that the monk dude who trained Morgan. That's his goat. Anyway. So this is continuing with the hunt for Wolverine stuff that's happening every week. This is Weapon Lost. This is Daredevil's team. Because if let's not talk about spoilers. But I agree. No spoilers. Thanks for the follow. So, this is the Submariner. This week is Sword Daughter number one. I have absolutely no idea what this is. The artwork looks great, and it seems to be set in a medieval or like 15th century at the most time frame. This is my copy. Still in your bag. I saw this in the previews a couple months ago and read like a quick excerpt about it, and it seemed okay. So I'm interested to read it and find out exactly what the Sword Daughter is. It's a book I didn't really enjoy, but I had to have great. Just because the art's great doesn't mean the story's great. It just didn't resound with me. Is that the right word? Give you a non-spoiling gist. Okay. So this is Death or Glory, issue 2. We talked about issue 1 last month, but this is a virgin cover, so there's no title. There's no barcode. There's no price, no nothing like that. It's just the artwork on the front and the back. And it's great because that's really why I started reading comic books, because the art was great. There's so many different styles, and you know, if you look back through history at comic books, you can see that while there was periods of comic book art, everything in those periods was very similar and very conformist. During the comic code era, even before then, everything was kind of just, I mean, because, you know, the technology was just not there. Everyone did everything by hand, and then they saw what sold, and then they just copied that. The way that they would print colors was very limited. The content that they could create was very limited. It just, now is just such a great time for comic book art. Mithras, what's up? I'm making fun of Amaranth. I mean, if I was making fun of Amaranth, I would have a very low cut shirt. Just randomly turn off your dark mode. It does it sometimes. No, I'm not. I actually very much enjoy ASMR. And while I have no ill will for Amaranth, but I can see why some people do. Can barely understand. You gotta turn the volume up. See, that's how it goes. Okay, let's stop talking about other streamers. Alright. But yeah, nowadays, comic books are so great. Especially now that creators make it. Is it boobs? Is that why? I have no idea. Yes. Yes, she is. Most of the time, at the very top of the IRL streaming area, because she does a lot of ASMR. But she does a lot of ASMR in very, revealing outfits, very airy outfits. She knows what the fuck she's doing. She knows why. And the people who watch her know exactly why. But hey, that's okay if that's what you want to do. And if Twitch allows it, be my guest. If that's what you want to watch, sure. But you're not going to get that kind of content here. So, Mithras, I saw you were streaming earlier. Did you have any awesome games? We're actually going to be playing Fortnite tomorrow night, so if you're around, we can do some squads. But yeah, with the era of content creator-owned content with comic books, you can basically do whatever you want as long as you have the money to do it. That's why you can get so much variance between artists, between books. It's fantastic. You just get to see a bunch of different kind of art styles. Like, yeah, of course, the art style of this looks like the most realistic is great, but that kind of gets old. You know, I like seeing variants. I like seeing new kinds of art crop up. ASMR was a thing. I thought it was just something she did. I'll have to come back later. This isn't really your thing, but I love the squad. Yeah, Mithras, dude, I totally understand. ASMR is not for everyone. And if it's not for you, I totally understand. You're not staying around. It is kind of weird. Not gonna lie. And then you start to like it, and you're like, wait, does that make me weird? And then you say, yeah, because that's okay, too. But yeah, it's a thing. It's been a thing for a little while on YouTube. Mainly on YouTube. But thanks for stopping by, man. So this is Batman number 48. It's a great cover. This is leading up to the wedding issue, which is going to be issue 50. The wedding between Batman and Catwoman. This is just Joker smashing down a chessboard, and it looks as the queen is Catwoman, and maybe the king is Batman. Now we've got Robin over here. Who is it? The Signal. That might be the Signal. Duke. Or Nightwing. Not Nightwing. Some kind of piece. They get very hard to distinguish. Oh, okay. Batgirl's the Rook. They've got Damien. Little Robin. And then a horse. Because no one can be the horse, I guess. Interesting cover. In addition to Batman 48, the lead up to the wedding, this is the prelude to the wedding. Nightwing versus Hush. Last week was Robin versus Deathstroke. Or I can't remember exactly who. But Hush hasn't been around for a little while, so should be a good read. Darkness, what's up? At work, no speakers, just through the stream up for support. Praise be. Speed. this, let's see if we can get it. There we go. It's not cross-hatching. It's just, like, lines that are thicker and closer together to create shadow. And, nothing's, like, completely filled in. And I really like that kind of, that style. And it's Batman and, you know, Selina, so it's pretty cool. It's just black and white. There's even some cats down here. It's pretty good. Okay. The devil will get his due. The Curse of Brimstone. Number 3. This is DC's Ghost Rider. I actually met the writer, Justin Jordan. He's fantastic. Hour-long conversation about comic books and the comic book industry, because obviously, you know, I don't write comic books, I just sell them, you know. I don't see that side of the comic book industry very often, and he had a lot of good insight. It's another great cover this week. This is the variant cover for Deathstroke. Deathstroke. It's just like a very red, vibrant cover. It's got like kind of an angel down here with some blood. It's very striking. It's a very cool cover. Sold out of that one pretty quick. Pup's asleep. Justice League number 1 started today. This is the Batman variant. I'm not quite sure why Batman's the only one who got a variant, but it's a sweet cover. It's got the pseudo virgin cover with everything very, all the text very, very tiny down here. Very cool. Of course, it's a new number. It's a blank variant, so I've got to get it. Of a book that I like, you know. I'm not really a big fan of the Deadpool comics right now, or the Doctor Strange comics. So I didn't get those blank covers. I don't even know if there were. There might have been blank covers for them. I'm sure there were. But, had to get this one, because I can take it to a convention. Get an artist sketch on it, maybe of, I don't know, Martian Manhunter, because he's the new leader of the Justice League, or, what's her face, I can't remember, Lobo's daughter, who's previewed in the back of this book. It's, it previews Teen Titans number 20, which is going to be the first appearance of Lobo's daughter. See, because I don't know if this book or if Teen Titans 20 is going to be accredited with the first appearance. Yeah, I think the Justice League one will. People are already saying that this is the first appearance. Are so weird. Like, there's like three different disputed first appearances of the Black Suit Spider-Man. Two different Sir Darler is cool so far. Tell me about it. There's a couple different first appearances of Black Cat. It's crazy. Comic books are weird. And this is the Justice League number 1. It's kind of got all the mainstays. It's actually got Jon Stewart, which is my favorite Justice League Odyssey. And then the week after that is whichever one is next week. So we've got a bunch of new Justice League stuff coming out, and sweet, like, Darkseid is on one of the teams. Like, what? Swamp Thing's back, Zatanna's back. I think Hellblazer is on the Justice League Dark again. I can't remember. Not quite sure why I'm still getting this book, because now we have two copies in the house. But this is Shade the Changing Woman number 4. I've actually never read any Shade. I don't know why I still get this book. I should probably give it back. Says Girl's Village is attacked when she's 2. Her father survives, but I guess was asleep for 10 years. Seeks vengeance on her family. But her dialogue bubbles are only symbols. Everyone else speaks normally, but she does narrate. That's interesting. I don't know, I guess I'll have to read it to really kind of form an opinion. Alright. This is the Unexpected number 1. It's another new team spinning out of metal. Find your number 1 for Shade so you can start reading it. Yep. I think it's down here. This is another new number 1. These characters of the Dark Knight's Metal event that took place a couple months ago. This book got delayed a little bit. It references the Dragon Hawkman, who was at the Forge of Worlds, and he was like the blacksmith of the Forge of Worlds. He was like imprisoned there. And that took place like months and months ago, so the timeline for this metal tie-in stuff, or spinning out of metal stuff, is very, very strange. But it seems like an okay team. They're all new characters, so we've got all new backstories to learn about, and new interactions. It's pretty cool. Go to any details to not spoil. The whole thing is pretty short, so she doesn't speak normally. There's not a lot to read. Makes sense. Okay, we're getting down to the nitty gritty. And by that I mean there's 2 more books. This one, I can't believe there's not more hype around this book. This is Halo Collateral Damage. Number 1. So Halo had a book in a little while. But that's not the point of this book. So this book takes place before events of Halo 1. This is back when there's a bunch of different Spartans. Didn't even know there was a comic. Yeah, there's been a couple different Halo storylines. So, this takes place probably near the times of Halo Reach, which is before the first one, when there's still an abundance of Spartans. And the Spartan Project is still going strong. And this is Master Chief and his squad. And they're gonna go kill some Covenant dudes, because the Covenant are still bad guys, and they don't know the Arbiter yet. So the thing about this book, the biggest thing ever, when the games were still new, everyone's like, we just want to see John's face, Master Chief. We just want to see his face. He, like, takes off his helmet, and we don't see anything because it, like, cuts away in the TV show or, like, Netflix short or whatever it was, YouTube short. Never saw his face. Like, 3 panels into the fucking comic book, they're like, Dr. Halsey's like, yeah, John, are you okay? And he's just like, no Spartan outfit, nothing. And he's like, yeah, I'm fine. He's just got like a regular face. How is this not more bombshell? Why are people not talking about this? Like, maybe I'm making a bigger deal was in the other comic books. Maybe they showed his face somewhere that I don't remember. But, so Beckett. Let's see. In 2017 of May, so about a year ago, no one had seen his face. So still as recent as that, so this has to be the first appearance of his face. Was he just some generic white dude? Yeah. He had like a military buzz cut, brown hair, pale skin. Maybe like a weird nose, you know, like a comic book stylistic nose, but that was it. Maybe this is just like a... Okay, so it says in Halo 4 Legendary Ending Master Chief face reveal. I'm gonna have to watch this later. So it's YouTube. Is the legendary ending of Halo 4. A Halo I did not complete. So maybe his face was revealed a long time ago and it was a bigger deal back then. I'm gonna be a dicker, make it a race thing, but he's probably why no one cares. Plus no one cares about Halo. I think it's more that no one cares about Halo anymore. And we've known that he's a white dude. Master Chief, let's get on to the last thing. This is a, an ash can, but it's a different kind of ash can. It's what Dark Horse does with their ash cans. It's more like a preview book of books. So it's four different titles in here, and there's maybe like two pages each, giving you a preview of the books to come. So we've got She Could Fly, which is, I believe, the writer and artist from Ice Cream Man. They didn't take any risks, they just made him standard male character, yeah. So people working on Ice Cream Man are working on She Could Fly for Dark Horse. And then we've got Olivia Twist. Don't recognize any of the names on him, but Olivia Twist. The Seeds, which I believe is about, God, I'm gonna get this so wrong, some kind of like artificial or factory made foods. I feel like it's that. I read a small excerpt like months ago. And we've got Alcoholic, a book called Alcoholic in the Art. Looks, I'll show you. Excited for that one. It's not an Ice Cream Man, but it's made by the same people. So Alcoholic looks very Picasso. Very non-traditional art. But that's okay, because that's exactly what I was talking about earlier. You've got four different books, and we can see three of the different art styles. Don't know what that one is, but you know. That's what makes comic books so great right now. Just do whatever the fuck you want. Alright. That's gonna do it for comic books. We're gonna stay streaming. But I just wanna sign off for those of you on YouTube who may have made it this far. Appreciate you. Hope to see you around. I'm eventually gonna make a playlist that has all of the ASMR stuff in it. I have yet to get around to that as I drop my pen. Alright. So, 57 minutes. We have to mark that down. I have to write that down, but I need my pen. Okay, so that stops about 57 minutes. we're staying streaming. We're gonna stay ASMR. We're gonna stream. I'm gonna put these comic books away. Then I'm gonna find the PDFs for making a D&D character. We're gonna work on a D&D character, but stay ASMR. Let's move this stuff. And then we're gonna change the mic around to thing that made me angry about this week was not having all 8 of the 8 covers of Spawn. I'm not missing number 1, I'm not missing number 8, I'm missing number 6. It's like, come on, Diamond, what are you doing? It's not that hard when you're pulling books for me. You just get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They should all be in a row, you know. I don't know how Diamond does it. But they always screw up. They always manage to screw up. Sorry, I'm the Witcher, so you won't be listening much. Alright. There's also a special character sheet that I can use that's form fillable, so I can fill it out on the internet. Yeah, here we go. Okay, let's see. I'm gonna move this stuff over here. Position. Just gotta set it up in OBS. It's not. Why is this not working? Why can I not find this window? Sometimes I don't understand OBS. It'll work like for one scene and then not work for another. Okay, never mind. I give up. I give up. See, it works in one. Here, let's just. It works in one scene, but not another. Sucks. But what kind of character do we want to make? Let me start. I'm gonna go. the stream. Someone's running over to the Dragon Queen. That's pretty cool. Okay, update information. That's all good. Let's get rid of that. Okay, so we can. I want to make a race class that I've never made before. So I can't make an elf, and I can't make a dragon. Walking speed is 30. That's pretty good. They have dark vision. You gain proficiency in intimidation. That's pretty good. When you're reduced to 0 hit points but not killed outright, you can drop to 1 point instead and use this feature again until you long rest. That's kind of good. Not being able to die. When you score a critical hit with a melee weapon attack, you can roll one of the weapon's damage die one additional time and add it to the extra damage of the critical hit. Common and orc. Okay, what about tieflings? Tieflings are derived from human bloodlines, and in the broadest possible sense, they still look human. Infernal heritage. They've got horns. Oh god. Thick tails of 4 to 5 feet. So Frieza from DBC. Is this on the right setting, by the way? Did I do that right? It should be. Should be able to hear. Sounds all over. Let me know if it doesn't work. Let me know if I'm just spinning around the microphone for no, like, actual no reason. Subsistence, small minorities found mostly in human cities and towns. Okay. So what do they get? They like intelligence and charisma. They're about the same size built as humans. Your size is medium. Base walking speed is 30. Thanks to your infernal resistance to fire damage. That's pretty good. Fire-breathing dragon. Got resistance to it. You know, the Thaumaturgy cantrip. Once you reach their level, you can cast the Hell's Rebuke spell once per day as a second level spell. That's pretty good. You can also cast the Darkness spell once per day. Christmas, your spell casting ability for these spells. It doesn't show our level. This is very interesting. Character sheet. Okay, so let's go to page 51. I want to read about just vibrations of air, but vocalizations of power all their own. The bard is a master of song, speech, and the magic they contain. Bards say that the multiverse was spoken into existence, that the words of the gods gave it shape, and that echoes of these primordial worlds of creation still resound throughout the cosmos. The music of bards is an attempt to snatch and harness those echoes subtly woven into their spells and powers. Okay. True bards are not common in the world. Not every minstrel singing in a tavern or jester catering in a royal court is a bard. So these people aren't just entertainers. They are people who know that music in this world is a very magical thing. So they like charisma and dexterity. So we know that charisma is a good one for tieflings. Or is it constitution? I think it's charisma. Let's go back. It's charisma, okay. Charisma. It's okay though. They are simple weapons, ain't crossbows, long swords, rapiers, short swords. Three musical instruments of your choice. You can choose any three skills to be proficient with. That's pretty good. That's real good. So that means it doesn't take a spell slot to cast. You can pick up Bard College at level 3. There's a couple different ones. And that's it. Alright, so... what else do we have? Wizards are magic users that learn a few reading, you know, that kind of thing. Power magic draw students who seek their master's mysteries. Okay. Wizards live and die by the spells. Everything else is secondary. They learn new spells as they experiment and grow in experience. They can also learn them from other wizards, from ancient tomes or inscriptions, and from ancient creatures, such as the steeped in magic. At first level, they get spell casting, arcane recovery, 3 cantrips, and 2 spell slots. Let's see what arcane recovery is. Arcane recovery says you have learned to regain some of your magic energy by studying your spellbook once per day. When you finish a short rest, you can choose to expend spell slots. You can choose expended spell slots to recover. The spell slots have a combined level that is equal to or less than half your wizard level rounded up. And none of those slots can be 6th level or higher. For example, if you're a 4th level wizard, you can recover up to 2 levels worth of spell slots. You can recover either a 2nd level spell slot or 2 1st level spell slots. So if you're level 1, you can just get 1 spell slot back after a short rest. I'm sorry about that. I really didn't mean to bump the microphone. Okay, so they get a bunch of different schools. They obviously have a bunch of different kinds of spells to choose from. At first level, you know 3 cantrips of your choice from the wizard spell list. Your spellbook. The spells that you add to your spellbook as you gain levels reflect the arcane research you conduct on your own, as well as intellectual breakthroughs you have had about the nature of the multiverse. You might find other spells during your adventures. You could discover a spell recorded on a scroll in an wizard's chest, for example, or in a dusty tome in an ancient library, copying a spell to the book. When you find a wizard spell of 1st level or higher, you can add to your spell book if it's at the level which you have spell slots, and if you can spare the time to decipher and copy it. Copying a spell into your spell book involves reproducing the basic form of the spell, then deciphering the unique system of notation used by the wizard who wrote it. You must practice the spell until you understand the sound or gestures required, then transcribe it into your spellbook using your own notation. For each level of the spell, this process takes 2 hours and costs 50 gold. Why does it cost 50 gold? The cost represents the material and components you expended as you experiment with the spell to master it, as well as the fine inks you need to record it. Once you have spent this time and money, you can prepare the spell just like your other spells. Okay. Your spellbook is unique. Is a unique compilation of spells with its own decorative flourishes and margin notes. It might be a plain functional leather volume that you received as a gift from your master, a finely bound, gilt-edged tome you found in an ancient library, or even a loose collection of notes scrounged together. says cantrips known, 3. But at first level, you get a spell book that has 6 spells in it. That's insane. That's so much. You can use an arcane focus found in chapter 5 as a spellcasting focus for your wizard. There's hair in my face. Okay, so... second level, you can choose an arcane tradition shaping your practice. Is it the school? Yeah, I think that's the school. Arcane traditions. School of abjuration. Emphasizes magic that blocks, banishes, or protects. School of conjuration. Objects and creatures out of thin air. You can conjure billowing clouds of killing fog, or summon creatures from elsewhere to fight on your behalf. As your mastery grows, you can learn spells and transportation. You can teleport yourself across vast distances, even to other planes of existence, in an instant. Starting level 2, when you select this school, you can use your action to conjure up an inanimate object in your hand or on the ground in an unoccupied space you can see within 10 feet. This object can be no larger than 3 feet on a side and weigh no more than 10 pounds, and its form must be that of a non-magical object that you've seen. When can I conjure things? Small, medium creature. Let's use this feature you get. I don't know. Maybe you just get access to different spells. School of Divination. The Council of a Diviner is sought by royalty and commoners alike, for all seek a clear understanding of the past, present, and future. Glimpse of the future in person. When you finish a long rest, roll 2d20s and record the numbers rolled. You can replace any attack roll, saving throw, or ability check with those. That's pretty good. School of Enchantment. Beginning when you select this, the gold and time you spend to copy an enchantment into your spellbook is half. That's pretty good. Not having to spend so much money. 50 gold for one spell. It's a lot. Can't believe they would make it cost that much. I mean, I guess you kinda gotta be devoted to that spell to want to copy it. So you can use enchant weapons. Looks like you just enchant things. Like charm people. Focus your study on magic that creates powerful elemental effects such as bitter cold, searing flame, rolling thunder, crackling lightning, and burning acid. You can create pockets of relatively safety within the effects of your evocation spells. When you cast an evocation spell that affects other creatures that you can see, you can choose a number of them equal to 1 plus the spell's level. The chosen creatures automatically succeed on their saving against the spell. Okay, so you can save your allies. Illusion. When you choose this school on second level, you learn the minor illusion cantrip. If you already knew this cantrip, you learn a different wizard cantrip of your choice. Doesn't count against your number of cantrip. Both a sound and an image. Pretty good. Necromancy. The school of necromancy explores the cosmic forces of life, death, and undeath. As you focus your studies in this tradition, you learn to manipulate the energy that animates all living things. As you progress, you learn to sap the life force from a creature as your magic destroys its body. fascination with death. Not all necromancers are evil, but the forces they manipulate are considered taboo by many societies. Grim Harvest and second level, you gain the ability to reap life from creatures you kill with your spells. Once per turn, when you kill one or more creatures with a spell of first level or higher, you regain hit points equal to twice the spell's level, or three times the level of the spell belongs to the school of necromancy. Constructs are undead. At 6th level, you add the Animate Dead spell to your spellbook if it's not there already. When you cast Animate Dead, you can target one additional corpse pile or pile of bones, creating another zombie or skeleton as appropriate. I like that. I like necromancy. I could see this character being a necromancy wizard. Kind of warlock character. Our student of spells that modifies energy and matter. You can temporarily alter the physical properties of one non-magical artifact. Okay. Dark vision, transmuter stone. Starting at level 6, you spend 8 hours creating a transmuter stone that stores transmuting magic. You can benefit from the stone yourself or give it to another creature. Dark vision. Speed, proficiency, constitution, resistance to damage. So what do I need? Constitution, intelligence, dexterity. If you plan to join the School of Enchantment, make charisma. Size are we medium? Player name. FX. Okay, let's go to tiefling stuff. Too far. These classes are not in alphabetical order. It's a little tilting. So our intelligence gets upped by one. I don't know exactly what it's going to be yet. So then charisma goes up by two. I don't have any dice. So we're just going to take the points that they give you, which is 50. Charisma to be the 15. So that's actually plus the 2, that's 17. dexterity needs to be high too, so we can do that as 14. Then we can do intelligence as 13. So plus 1, that's 14. Now we have 12, 10, and 8. I think my... Constitution could be 10. Wisdom can be 8. Okay. Now that we have all those, we can go by the modifiers. 12 and 13 are plus 1. So we got plus 1 here. Got no other 12s or 13s. 14 to 15 is plus 2. So that's stats. I could get some dice and roll for my stats, but not gonna do that. Okay. Tieflings mature at the same rate as humans, but live a few years longer. So let's say, that's how old I am. Male infernal names. I like Morthos. Size of medium alignment might not have any innate tendencies towards evil, but may end up there evil or not. An independent nature inclines many tieflings towards a chaotic. We'll say chaotic good. Chaotic good. Let's spell it out. Too small. Okay. Next. Speed. Base walking speed is 30. God, I can't see. Because it's run speed. That's fine. Hellish resistance. So you spell resistance. Let's go down here to spells. Cantrip. Can take care of the spells later. Languages. Common and infernal. Sucks that it's not like on the line. It's weird. Okay, that's it for tiefling specific things. Let's go down to Bard. Hit points are 1d8. That's the die 1d8 per Bard level. Let's zoom in. And short swords. That's insanely tiny. Alright. We can, I guess we can do away with this and make it a little better, a little easier to read. Expenses, trinkets, These are weapons. Musical instruments is what I meant. Okay. Bagpipes, drum, dulcimer, flute, lute, lyre, horn, pan flute, shawn, viol. I'm gonna pick bagpipes, a lute, and a viol. Saving throws, dexterity, charisma. Get rid of this. Dexterity and charisma. Okay. You start with the following equipment in addition to the equipment granted by your background. Sword or C, any simple weapon. I'm gonna go with a rapier. I think. Let's see. Any simple weapon. Rapier's a martial weapon, so it's probably good. I could get a long sword too, 1d8 slashing. It's a versatile. I could go two-handed with it to get 1d10 of damage. Instead of the base, 1d8. Let's just go with a basic longsword then. 1d8 slashing. Versatile. Could be versatile. Slashing damage, so we can highlight the circle next to S for slashing, right? Set operational. There we go. And that is a long sword. So I believe it would be my dex to that. My strength. I'm not sure. I feel like I would add my strength, but let's set back. I feel like I would add my dexterity. We could look into that. Diplomat's pack. So that only makes sense, you know. Leather armor and a dagger. Get leather armor. I get a dagger. So let's go see what those give us. Thrown. What's the range, 20 and 60? Yep, 20 and 60. Okay, this is piercing damage. So, I want to click that one. Sir. Okay, there we go. Oh my god. Let me enter somewhere. Gotta go back to get leather armor. Let's check this place for... It's just strength when I use that. Okay, so for dagger, this is a finesse weapon, correct? No, light weapon. I use finesse, okay. So I use dexterity bonus and my proficiency bonus. Which is plus 2. To make this a plus 3 on attack rolls. And the longsword would be, actually no, so 2 plus 2 is 4, not 3. Idiot. This would be plus 3. This is my strength modifier, 1 plus 2. That's it for starting equipment. So first level, my proficiency bonus is plus 2. I get spellcasting and bardic inspiration. I know 2 cantrips. And 4 spells. I already know thaumaturgy. That's a racial thing, so I can still pick my cantrips for being a bard. Spell slot, or 2 first level spell slots. Yep, 2. Okay. You know, 2 cantrips of your choice in the bard spell list. You get an additional higher level. So okay, yep. The spell's no golem, but the bard stable shows you. Christmas, your spellcasting ability for your bard spells. Your magic comes from the heart and soul, important to the performance of your music and oration. Use your charisma, whatever you spell refers to your spellcasting ability. In addition, use your charisma modifier when setting the saving throw DC for your bard spell. You cast, okay, spell save DC is 8 plus 2 plus my charisma modifier, which is 3. So it's 13. DC is 13. My spell modifier is charisma. My total number of spells known is 4. So anytime I attack with a spell, I get to add plus 5. I have ritual casting. I can use a musical instrument as my spell focus. You can inspire others through stirring words or music. To do so, you can use a bonus action on your turn to choose one creature other than yourself within 60 feet who can hear you. That creature gains one bardic inspiration die, a d6. Once within the next 10 minutes, the creature can attack, can roll the die in addition to the, whatever they rolled for the ability check, attack roll, or saving throw it makes. The creature can wait until after the roll, after it rolls the d20 before deciding, but must decide says whether the attack succeeds or fails, or the roll succeeds or fails. Okay. So we get this is 1d6. So I think this character is going to be a kind of character who might be in melee range to attack with the longsword, but also able to kind of help others and maybe cast some spells. We're making a tiefling bard, so maybe a little bit of offensive spells, but some team helping spells. These don't work at all. There we go. That's our next cantrip. Probably Mage Hand, right? Mage Hand is super. Magic mouth. What? cast the spell again. You can use your action to control the hand. You can use the hand to manipulate an object, open an unlocked door or container, stow or retrieve an item from an open container, or pour the contents of a vial. You can move the hand up to 30 feet each time you use it. The hand can't attack, activate magic items, or carry more than 10 pounds. Okay, so as well. Mage Ant. Alright, so we know four spells. Let's go down to our spells here. We have two spell slots. I love the art on these pages. Like little bubbles here to fill in when you've expended some of those spell slots. Pretty cool. Okay, so we get no four spells from the Bard class. First level animal friendship, Bane, Charm Person, Cumbrian Languages, Cure Wounds, Disguise Self. Oh, jeez. Of your choice that you can see within range perceives everything as hilariously funny and falls into fits of laughter. The spell affects it. The target must succeed on a wisdom saving throw or fall prone, becoming incapacitated and unable to stand up for the duration. A creature with an intelligence score of 4 or less is affected. At the end of each of its turns, each time it takes damage, target can make another wisdom saving throw. Target has advantage on saving throws if it's triggered by damage. On a success, the spell ends. I need a material. I need tiny darts and a feather that is waved in the air. Let's do Tasha's hideous laughter. That's pretty great. So a bard gets 5d4 times 10 gold. Let's just say we roll an average of 5 times 3. So, I mean, yeah, 15 times 10. So we start with 100 gold. to class yet. These are feats. Ability score. Where are backgrounds? I must be chapter 5. Or chapter 4. Nope. It's really hard to go around a PDF. Some paladins. Charlatan, maybe. Criminal, nope. Entertainer. You thrive in front of an audience. You know how to entrance them, entertain them, and even inspire them. Your poetics can stir the hearts of those who hear you, awakening grief or joy, laughter or anger. Your music raises their spirits and captures their sorrow. Your dance steps captivate. Your humor cuts to the quick. Whatever techniques you use, your art is your life. Okay. Oh, I never picked my proficient skills. I get 2 of any kind. Definitely want some charisma ones. Performance, yes. Persuasion, yes. There we go. Easy piece. Oh, this one gives you performance, so maybe I'll pick something. Dexterity, sleight of hand. That could be interesting. Okay. Yeah, I'm just gonna go with that one. I get proficiencies with acrobatics and performance. So it changes this. We don't actually need to add the numbers, but if you're proficient with something, you add your proficiency bonus and your modifier for whatever stat it is. So it's plus 4. It's plus 4. And these are both going to be +5s. Cool. So I get a disguise kit. I'm proficient with a disguise kit and one type of musical instrument. Okay. Can I put that in proficiencies? Thank you. place to perform, usually in an inn tavern, but possibly with a circus. Such a place, you receive free lodging. Fine lodging. What else is important with this? Is it free lodging and food, or a modest and comfortable standard, depending on the quality of the establishment? As long as you perform each night, in addition, your performance makes something of a local figure. Strangers to recognize you in town you have performed typically take a liking to you. Okay, so free lodging. Successful entertainers have to be able to capture and hold an audience's attention, so they tend to have flamboyant or forceful personalities. They are inclined towards the romantic and often cling to high-minded ideals about the practice of art and the appreciation of beauty. My personal trait is, there's a bunch of different ones I can pick from. I know a story relevant to almost every situation. Okay, that could go very well with storyteller. Guessing you're a bard. Yeah, I did answer your question. It's a tiefling bard, who's a melee character that has sort of bardy and defensive magics to be used in melee. He's gonna be of the storytelling kind. Whenever I come to a new place, I collect local rumors and spread gossip. I'm a hopeless romantic, always searching for that special someone. Nobody stays angry at me or around me for long, since I could diffuse. Oh, stays angry at me or around you, okay. So you exited briefly, so you probably missed it, yeah. What's this character for? No idea. Just for fun. It's fun making characters, thinking of ideas on what this character could possibly be. Maybe at some point, if I need another character, I can use this character for some adventure, you know, if we need another character, I could just use this guy, or, you know, whatever. I get bitter if I'm not the center of attention. I'll settle for nothing less than perfection. I'll change my mood or my mind as quickly as I change key in a song. Okay, let's go with the I know a story relevant to almost every situation. I spelled that wrong. Okay, that's a personal trait. Let's do ideal beauty when I perform. I make the world better than it was. Tradition, the stories, legend, and songs of the past must never be forgotten, for they teach us who we are. Creativity. The world is in need of new ideas and bold action. That goes with the chaotic nature of a tiefling, so I'm gonna go with that one. And what did it say? The world is in need of new ideas and bold action. Ideas or ideals. instrument is my most treasured obsession, and it reminds me of someone I love. Someone stole my precious instrument, and someday I'll get it back. I want to be famous, whatever it takes. I idolize a hero of the old tales and measure my deeds against that person, so I will do anything to prove myself superior to my hated rival. I would do anything for the other members of my old troop. For the other members, okay, no. I idolize a hero of the old tales. It's my dog. She's sleeping. My god. Very entertainer. Gladiator. A gladiator is as much an entertainer as any. Okay. It's kind of a demand feature. You can play sports. Nope, no thanks. Okay. So that's that. Casting save is 13. And 4 total slots. I don't have a companion. My initiative is passive perception is 12. Is it? No, it's 9. Because I believe it's 10 minus your, or 10 plus your wisdom. I've got my HP, I've got my run speed, I've got all my equipment, my spells, my armor, my gold, my height, my weight, eyes, skin color, that doesn't really matter. Don't really have a deity. Stuff already have it. This bard. Yeah, that's it. We're all set. And we have a tiefling bard named Morthos. Who's chaotic good, and he's an entertainer. Lots of cool spells. Some cool cantrips. Interesting fighting style. This is really fun. I like it. I like this form fillable character sheet. I like being able to create it on the go, kinda, and not have to write everything down, you know? Just easier for me to type. And it looks great. It's very cool. But, alright, so I guess that's gonna do it for our ASMR stream. We're at about 2.5 hours, which is pretty good for an ASMR stream. With no gaming. Normally with the gaming, we can push the 3 hours. But, hope everyone had a great night. I always enjoy ASMR. It's one of my favorite things to do while I'm trying to fall asleep. So watch some great ASMR artists. And ASMR on Twitch can become a bigger thing than it already is. Because it's great. Alright, everyone. I'm going to thank you all for stopping by. I had a great night. Made an awesome character. Oh, maybe next time we can make a different character. Maybe use a different character sheet, too. There's some pretty cool ones. Thanks all for the follows and the hosts. Tomorrow we'll be playing some more State of Decay and some Fortnite. So we'll be back at a normal volume for that. I thank everyone for watching, and I hope you all have a great night. I'll see you tomorrow.